So again, welcome to church today on this first Sunday of Lent. We acknowledge that we are on the territory of the Shuswap and Tanaha nations and the chosen homeland of the Métis, and we seek to live in conscious and right relationships with our Indigenous neighbors and friends. I invite us to come into the present moment, the simple ways of doing that, just simply bringing our attention to what we're seeing, what we're hearing, what we're feeling, what we're sensing. Step out of our minds and into the present moment. Our invocation song is "O God We Call" by Linnea Good. Today is the first Sunday of Lent. Lent is the 40-day period before Easter, not including Sundays. 40 is a symbolic number in various world religions. In the Hebrew tradition and story, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. The Hebrews wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. Moses was on top of Mount Sinai for 40 days, communing with the sacred and receiving the commandments, as the story goes. In the Christian story, Jesus fasted for 40 days and 40 nights in the Judean desert, and there were 40 days between the resurrection and the ascension. 40 spoke to a time of passage, to a time of change, to the transition between one way of being and another. Today, we are going to hear how Jesus's time in the desert could be referred to as a liminal time. The words liminal and liminality derive from the Latin word limen, meaning a threshold, that is, the bottom part of a doorway that must be crossed when entering a building. Liminal times are threshold times between one way of being and doing and another, between an ending and a new beginning. And life is full of liminal periods and experiences. All significant transitional experiences, like becoming an adult, leaving home, getting into a committed relationship, pregnancy, becoming parents, moving, retiring, having a common belief or understanding, change or become inadequate, losing an identity that one has had for oneself, are some of the life experiences that may move us into a liminal period. They can be experienced as times of wilderness, uncertainty, not knowing how to be or where to go or what is going to happen next. Liminal times can be scary and disruptive, as they can also incubate broader ways of seeing and being. They can be creative. Come, let us continue on our spiritual journey on this first Sunday of Lent. To the desert Jesus came.
Say when?
No.
Thank you.
So, more words of wisdom. Liminality can describe the evolving state of an individual, place, organization, or institution. Anything stuck in the neutral space between an ending and a new beginning. Liminal times can be relatively short, or sometimes take decades, generations, or even centuries to resolve. Congregations regularly experience liminal seasons. Liminal seasons are threshold experiences where the continuity of tradition is called into question and uncertainty about the future fuels doubt. So this is from Susan Beaumont from her book, How to Lead When You Don't Know Where You're Going, Leading in a Liminal Season. There is a sweet spot between the known and the unknown where originality happens. The key is to be able to linger there without panicking. And now this is a quote from Richard Rohr. All transformation takes place in liminal times. We have to allow ourselves to be drawn out of business as usual and remain patiently on the threshold, limen in Latin, where we are betwixt and between the familiar and the completely unknown. There alone is our old world left behind. While we are not yet sure of the next existence, that's a good space where genuine newness can begin. Get there often and stay as long as you can by whatever means possible. It's the realm where God can best get at us because our false certitudes are finally out of the way. This is the sacred space where the old world is able to fall apart and a bigger world is revealed. If we don't encounter liminal space in our lives, we start idealizing normalcy. The threshold is God's waiting room. Here we are taught openness and patience as we come to expect an appointment with the divine doctor. From Richard Rohr. And seems, helpful words, hopefully, for us to hear on this Sunday as we have our focus once again on the story of Jesus in the wilderness, which will be our focus of our service today.
Oh. Well. Hey, Brent.
Hi, Brent. Hi.
Look at my pictures there. You know what? I put those up there.
Yeah.
Sent them in.
Thank you.
But guess what? It's kind of like me in a lemonade stand.
No, not lemonade. Liminal.
Oh, sorry. Liminal.
That's quite a word, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're probably not used to that word.
But you know what those are pictures of? They were me in my wilderness because I'm in between and betwixt. I'm moving places.
Oh,
yeah.
And why are you moving places?
Well, I moved once before. And I guess that was also one of those times between and betwixt when I moved away from mom and off on my own place.
Yeah.
And now I have to move my place again.
Okay, yeah. Why are you moving your place again?
Housing's an issue, but people are building houses near where I've been and it gets noisy. And I just want to get into a little quieter place. Plus, I was thinking I'd go somewhere kind of between Fairmont and Invermere so that it's easier to either come here or to go to the church, sort of. So
thank you. That's very thoughtful of you because you never know, when we're going to meet again in the church. Yeah.
I had a sad thought that I'm not a refugee, but it's like people, isn't it sad that there's all those people? And it's not just the Ukraine. There's other places in the world where it's always happening, where people are, they're settled somewhere and then they're between and betwixt, they're moving and they just don't know where they're going. And it's a wilderness for them. Mine's way easier. Mm. Yeah.
Well, that's very thoughtful of you, Benny. Thank you for that, because it's true. You know, it's almost like we get settled or we get order in our life and then life really, and it's really disrupting the people in the Ukraine. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're sort of in a wilderness or liminal time.
For sure. Too.
But it's helpful that, because children end up going through these sort of wilderness or liminal times.
Yeah.
I suppose whenever we move, like when a child moves and they say goodbye to a familiar house or friends or neighborhood, and they don't know what it's going to be like in a new place. And then when you move into a new school, you don't know what it's going to be like. And it's kind of scary and all that kind of stuff. And then I think, too, when a child moves from being a child to an adult and leaving home.
It was hard when I left my mom. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I think throughout our life, we kind of go through those,
those
experiences. But, you know, in the story we're reading today, Jesus was about to become a leader.
Uh-huh.
And he was about to lead people in living God's way.
Huh. And I never thought of that. I always thought like it was like he was always a born leader, but.
You know, he was like a private citizen, and then he was about to become a public, citizen or public person.
Uh-huh.
But before he could lead in God's way, he needed to go out into the wilderness and he needed to get to know himself really well and get to know the voices that were in his head. And he had to sort of decide, what does it mean to follow God's way versus the way of the world? And
almost like we all have that journey.
Ideally. Yeah. I mean, unfortunately, I think a lot of us kind of dodge our time in the wilderness and we don't reflect deeply and we don't really know what voices are in our head. And I think that's part of the purpose of Lent, is for us to get to know ourselves better. And
sometimes maybe people get in the wilderness and their first thought is, get me out of here.
I think the idea of the wilderness is, it's a scary time. It was scary for Jesus, but so important. It is so important.
Huh.
to have times where we reflect and go deeper and listen to the voices in our head and what does it mean to just be connected to God?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, anyway, you never asked, but I did find a new place. So yeah, I'm happy about that. Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. A lot quieter. But I'm gonna go now and what?
No, well, I just don't know what a new place
it's a little further. But you know, I'm not burning gas. I use my legs anyway. So it's just better exercise. I'll be in better shape. I better go.
Okay.
Yeah, bye.
Bye, Benny. All right, lovely. Okay, back to the shared screen. And our next hymn, Jesus Tempted in the Desert.
The first reading is Deuteronomy 26. Can you hear me? Deuteronomy consists of a series of addresses attributed to Moses. They serve to prepare the people of Israel for entering the land after the wilderness sojourn. The book of Deuteronomy likely did not take final form until the late 7th century BCE. The passage of today provides understandings based on covenant of where we came from and the basis of hope in God. What comprises covenant here? God gives. The people respond with offerings, confession, and celebration. This text describes covenant faith in action. Note how covenant becomes inclusive. Israel is not to celebrate alone. The Levites and the aliens who reside among you are included. Why? Israel lived as aliens in Egypt. The Levites had no tribal lands on which to raise crops in order to bring an offering of first fruits. In both cases, covenant calls for their inclusion because of the good God provides. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you. And you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God: "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number. And there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toll, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power, and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house." The gospel reading today is from Luke chapter 4. As the Hebrew people wandered through the wilderness for 40 years in their archetypal story, so Jesus has his time in the wilderness for 40 days. It is a time of testing, a time of transition, a time of discerning. Issues of allegiance are important in these texts. The early church declared Jesus as Lord in the face of the demand of Rome's emperors to be hailed as Lord. Jesus' refusal to serve the tempter reveals a similar tension. Allegiance is a form of trust. The text today confesses trust and allegiance that is grounded in God alone. Choices we may be asked to discern is our allegiance to lords of our society or to the Lord's voices and stories in our own minds. Can we discern what directs our lives? Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I will give it to anyone I please. If you, then, will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. May we hear sacred wisdom through these human texts. Thanks be to God. Amen.
There, I think I got my microphone working, so that's good. Well, I'm pleased or excited to talk with you today about this very rich passage that's in our Christian story. It's a deeply rich passage. Before Jesus does become a leader, teacher, preacher, healer, but just showing people what it means to live in God's way, it's like he needs to have this time in the wilderness. And it's such an interesting part of the story that the Spirit drives him into the wilderness. It's like the Spirit knows, the wisdom of God knows that Jesus needs to have this discerning time. Otherwise, he may not be fit to serve in God's way. And he goes into the wilderness and all the things that wilderness represents. I'm hoping today as we hear wilderness, we don't just, of course, hear it as a physical place, but it's a time in our lives, a psychological, spiritual, inner maybe time that perhaps all of us can relate to. You know, have we had wilderness experiences? Are we in a wilderness experience now? Not so much then a place, but like this interior sort of interior experience of life that we have. And of course, you know, it says he goes there for 40 days and 40 nights, but that's a biblical symbolic number. It's not so much a chronological time as it is a time of like pregnancy. It's a time, however long it takes, whatever is necessary. So if you and I, you know, end up in our wilderness experiences, it might be great if it's over in 40 days. It might go on for a year or two or five or 10, or maybe it's only a shorter period of time. And he's there by himself. Like, I guess that's the thing about a wilderness is that you're sort of alone, and you may feel not supported. And maybe it is a time of fasting. It's a time of vulnerability. And so those kind of things in the wilderness, he's not eating, he's fasting, he's becoming weaker. It says at the end, he's famished. He's really then quite vulnerable. And at the end of this time is when the tempter comes to him as such and tempts him with these three profound things. The first is to turn stones into bread. Now, of course, this is maybe just understood personally. He's not been eating for such a long time. Is it as simple to say that, oh, you know, here, just, you know, feed that inner hunger, the empty belly? But I think it's probably deeper than that. To turn stones into bread, it's like, for me, the bread represents materialism. It's almost like Jesus, you know, be the kind of leader who's going to put a Walmart in every community, and everything's free, and free car lots, and everybody can have their material needs met. Because isn't that the main and only purpose of life, is to be materially satisfied and full? And Jesus has to respond to say, no, it is said that we don't live by bread alone. We don't live by material abundance alone. People could have lots of material stuff in their life, but missing what's most important. And so then that the way the story goes is the tempter takes him up onto a mountain and shows him all the kingdoms of the world. He says, all these kingdoms belong to me. All the politics and power belong to me, which people often chuckle that political power sort of belongs to the devil and such. It says, if you bow down and worship me, you can be the ruler of all the nations of the world. You can take over Russia. You can change things in the Ukraine. You can have the power to stop all this, Jesus. You can have all this political power. Isn't that what it's about? And Jesus has to say, no, we're to serve God and God alone. So then the tempter takes Jesus and to the top of the pinnacle of the temple and says, throw yourself down from this high place, this pinnacle of the temple. And then the devil quotes scripture to Jesus, where Jesus was sort of responding to the tempter with scriptures. Now the devil's going to quote scripture to Jesus. Well, it says in Psalm 91, if you throw yourself down, the angels will come and bear you up before you schmuck yourself on the ground. Well, the Psalm doesn't use that word, but. And Jesus has to say, no, we're not to tempt the Lord your God. But it's like, you know, Jesus, just try, like, surely God won't let you suffer. If you are the Messiah, the Son of God, and if you're going to lead God's people, isn't this what people want? To be exempt from suffering? Isn't that a sign that when we suffer, that, well, where is God? How can there be a God if we suffer? Surely, if we're faithful, we're exempt from suffering. This is a really profound testing that Jesus is going through. And something that I heard a man named Walter Wink say many years ago, he said, every Jewish boy or girl in the time of Jesus would have failed these tests because every Jewish boy and girl was raised knowing what the Messiah was going to be like. They were raised knowing that the Messiah was going to meet their material needs, that the Messiah was going to have political power in the world, that the Messiah was going to exempt them from suffering. And every Jewish boy and girl would have failed this test. And Jesus grew up in that society, which raises a really good point or question. Was the tempter's voice the voice of Jesus' own people that he had internalized since childhood, from his parents, from his synagogue, from his rabbi, from his neighbors, that the voice in his mind was the voice that he had heard his whole life from his own people? Be this. This is what we expect you to be. This is who the Messiah, who a person of God should be. And so the tempter's like demonic voice was the voice of his own people that he had to say no to. Which raises all kinds of questions. Do you and I have voices in our head? And where do we get those voices from? The answer is absolutely yes, we do. And if we think we don't, we need our time in the wilderness, because all of us have voices in our head that speak all the time. And we need to, in the least, be aware of them. In the least. I read this profound book called Strangers in Their Own Land that I wrote an article about. Some of you may have read, but where Arlie Hochschild spends 5 years in Louisiana befriending people who are Tea Party supporters and then became Trump supporters. And she got to relate to them and hear them from an empathetic point of view. And she wrote about how they have deep stories. They have a deep story that they live. They have a deep story that plays in their minds. And when she wrote about this deep story, they all agreed on it. They said, you nailed it. You have articulated the deep story that we have in our lives and we live out. Well, that is helpful that people have deep stories that cause them to become Tea Party people or vote for Donald Trump. But that deep story could be interpreted as the voices in their head that affect how they see the world, how they see politics, how they're going to vote, how they're going to live. And of course, it's not just them that have deep stories. We all have deep stories. And man, it's pretty hard to be aware of the deep stories that we live out, that are in our heads. We're reading this book by Brené Brown, The Gifts of Imperfection. And in the book, she talks about how she was this researcher and she was writing books and she was a pretty high functioning person. And she was interviewing all kinds of people and doing her research. And then painfully came a realization there, she wasn't living a very healthy life. She wasn't happy. She wasn't well. She then went to see a therapist for a year. And with the help of the therapist, got to become more aware of what was driving her to, like she says, to please, to perform, and to be perfect, or to perfect, to please, perform, and perfect. And then began that she started to have more choices, not to please, not to perform, and not to perfect or be perfect. And she began to feel more at home in her own skin. It's like there was voices in her head saying, Brené Brown, be like this. You need to be like this to be a successful person, a successful woman, a successful daughter, and so on. And in a way, her year with the therapist was like her 40 days in the wilderness, in a way. Another question I have is, could Jesus have said no to going out in the wilderness? That the Spirit drove him into the wilderness, but could Jesus have said, no, Spirit, I'm not going? And what kind of leader would he have been? Maybe, well, we wouldn't be in church today or in Zoom church today, because he wouldn't have been a leader that we would feel somehow that the light of God came through. And then a question I have is, are there leaders who choose their wilderness time? And are there leaders who don't choose their wilderness time? Now I'm going to be, I hope not unfair, but I'm going to say, is it possible that people like Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin have avoided their wilderness time? They have not listened to their demons. They have not listened to the voices. They don't know what's driving them. And because of that, as leaders, they can do things that become demonic. They can destroy democracies for their own egoic purpose. They can want to enlarge some idea of empire in their head, and somehow it becomes okay for men, women, and children to die because they have avoided reflection and listening to what is driving them. Another question I have is, do Ukrainians and the rest of us have a tempting voice in our heads in times like this? A voice that says, you must resist. You need to have power. You need to fight back. And we're heroes if we do. And once we start it, we don't know how to stop it. And I know this is so, I mean, it's so almost wrong for me to be second guessing people who are living in a time, and I have no idea how I would be. None of us do. I'm just concerned that in a time like this, when darkness is thrown at people, if they respond in darkness, there becomes more darkness, more destruction, more violence. I heard on the news last night that they claim, I don't know, what, none of us know if it's right or not, that 10,000 Russian soldiers have been killed already. It's terrible, because those Russian soldiers aren't evil people. They're young Russian boys and girls, young men and women who don't really want to be there, and they're not fighting their war, they're fighting someone else's war. And if 10,000 of them die, that's, it's, I don't know what, there's no words for it. And if this goes on and thousands of people die, like, is there somehow an evil that just gets perpetrated? And because somehow we failed to discern the voices and choose a harder way. I wonder if it's easier to fight, if it's harder to say, not this way. There must be a different way. I don't know, but I wonder. I wonder if the choice in the wilderness and the choice that Jesus was facing was the choice between presence and absence. And what I mean is when you are the voices in your head and you don't know you're the voices, you don't know you're the deep stories, you don't know what's driving you, then it's not you. It's like you're programmed. It's like you're acting out someone else's stories or some deep story or someone else's voices, and you're absent. People talk about freedom. People think they're free. But until we've had our extensive time in the wilderness, we don't know what's driving us. We don't know the stories that drive us. And when we don't, we're absent. We're not present. So I wonder if what Jesus chose is presence. A question that came to me this week is, like, people would say, well, what is the point then? Like, if spirituality or being a spiritual person like Jesus, if you're not going to get materialism, material prosperity and wealth, if you're not going to get power, and if you're not going to be exempt from suffering, what's the point? Like, why be spiritual? Like why follow this God's way? Because what else is there if you don't get more materialism or exemption from suffering, or if you don't get power over things? What's left? Or what's better than that? It's a good question. But is there something better than that? Like, is there something better than just having all the stuff in the world, or an illusion that we're exempt from suffering or power over people? Is there something about waking up and living in presence that is better than all the things that the voices tell us that we could have if we just followed them? So, is this wilderness experience just for Jesus? Was it just for Jesus? Or is it something that is archetypal in all of us humans need to go through? And it's not, I mean, it's a tough time. And wilderness is, you could say, well, who wants to go into the wilderness? maybe that's true. But it reminds me of something I heard a long time ago. It was a person talking about hell and how hell is a place where we get reconciled with our true self. And the person said, if we knew what it was for, we would run to hell rather than living a lie for the rest of our life. If the wilderness is a place where we get to know ourselves better, where we discern the voices, where we get to know the deep stories and the things that drive us, it's not a bad place then. The Spirit knows what it's doing. And we need our time there. We need to know ourselves better. And only then can we be an instrument of good in this world. So lots to reflect on this story that's in our Christian scriptures. And I'm profoundly always grateful for it. And I think I'm just glad it's there. So thanks for listening today. Amen. Our hymn is "O Love, How Deep." Thanks, Carolyn and Greg. And thanks, Tess, for leading us in our prayer time today.
Okay, you're welcome. Let us pray. Compassionate God, there is much that we are thankful for this day. We are beginning a Lenten journey together as one, with the knowledge that as we journey, we will find your presence there with us. We make this journey holding each other up, sharing whatever load may come upon us, and are thankful that in the sharing, we experience your love and guidance. We ask for your presence as we strive to make our way. May your guiding hand be with us as we move from the comfortable, the familiar, to the new that may be uncertain. Help us as we move with you in prayer, acknowledging the threshold, the old to the new. We ask for your grace and compassion on us in our time of need. We are struggling with the weight of the world events. We pray for those who are experiencing illness, isolation, loneliness, or feeling the weight of the world on their shoulders. In the silence of our hearts, we would also add, Kareen, Donna, may all feel your loving touch, and may the hands that care for them extend your love through their actions. May we always be mindful of each other's needs. The world continues to be turned upside down with the war in the Ukraine. We ask for prayers for all leaders that a way will be found to bring the conflict to an end. We pray for the peoples of Ukraine, Russia, and the whole world. May all feel your gentle love as they struggle to go about their daily lives. We ask for your presence as we begin this journey through Lent. We rejoice in the gift of your Spirit. May we find strength through your steadfast love for all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Tess. Our closing hymn, on Eagle's Wings.
Eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of
Our benediction is written by Jan Richardson. Beloved is where we begin. If you would enter into the wilderness, do not begin without a blessing. Do not leave without hearing who you are. Beloved, named by the one who has traveled this path before you. Do not go without letting it echo in your ears. And if you find it is hard to let it into your heart, do not despair. That is what this journey is for. I cannot promise this blessing will free you from danger, from fear, from hunger or thirst, from the scorching of the sun or the fall of the night. But I can tell you that on this path, there will be help. I can tell you that on this way, there will be rest. I can tell you that you will know the strange graces that come to our aid only on a road such as this, that fly to meet us, bearing comfort and strength, that come alongside us for no other cause than to lean themselves toward our ear and with their curious insistence, whisper our name, beloved, beloved, beloved. From Jan Richardson, I am walking the path of peace.